Did they, in fact, in those very early days, did they ever try and disguise you? I mean, now we know you for who you are, but was there any...
Well, of course, in those days, in the big studios, which is a thing that's missing now, because they were really training grounds, beside being big glamour factories, whatever you want to call them. But when you were under contract to one of the big studios in those days, you worked all the time. You had tiny little parts in big pictures, and every once in a while you would get a big part in a tiny little picture. You did tests of all kinds. I did tests. I was called in, and I was told that I was going to test for the part of Chang in The Good Earth. So the man by the name of Jack Don, who was very famous as a makeup artist, the most famous of all, and he had designed eyes that made the Oriental features. I was put a thing on my head, so I was completely bald. I had a queue. I was stripped to the waist, darkened down, and I was to do the test with Paul Muni. And I went down. The test was a walking shot, a walking shot of maybe 50 feet. And the first thing Paul Muni said, there's a hell of a tall Chinaman. I didn't know what it meant. So what they did, they dug a trench. And Muni walked here and I walked in the trench. And I didn't get the part. They gave it to a Chinese person.
That sounds okay. Imagine you're the Chinaman. Now, let's have a look at a film that you made in the 30s, where you're more easily recognizable. If you can have a look at it now, it's a film called Born to Dance, which I have no doubt you remember. Let's have a look at it.
You really want to go on the stage?
Well, I hope to.
Success and all that, do you think that'll change you?
Of course not. Why do you ask?
Oh, I don't know. It just seems that kind of success always does something to people. At least I've noticed it.
Just recently?
Oh, Nora, the difference between you and girls that
amount to something?
I wish you knew what you amounted to with me.
Tell me.
I know too well that I'm just wasting precious time in thinking such a thing would be, that you could ever care for me. I'm sure you'll hate to hear that I adore you, dear, but grant me just the same. I'm not entirely for you be so easy to love, so easy to idolize, all others above, so worth the yearning for, that you can see your future with me. Cause you'd be all so easy to love.
Let's, Well, it's pretty bad, wasn't it? You know, I had a terrible experience with that. Now, that's a hard song. It became a big hit, you know, easy to love.
Beautiful song.
It's a beautiful song. But the range in it is frightening. And I was a little worried about it. I recorded the song, but then when I went to the preview of the picture, I was sort of interested in what I would sound like singing. And when I started to sing, it wasn't me. It was somebody else. It turned out to be a fellow by the name of Art Jarrett, who sang with the orchestra at home, that they'd put in because... but at the end, they... after the picture, the picture was quite successful. And at the end, they decided to leave my voice in because they said, you just can't hurt that tune, that Cole Porter tune. And so leave his voice in.
It sounded, in fact, as if your voice hadn't broken. You know, it's like a voice soprano, wasn't it?
Well, it's so high. Gee, I asked Cole Porter, I said, couldn't you cut it down a note or two? And he didn't like that at all. But the range, you know, the range is... and besides, I can't sing.
Did they ever try and sort of build you up into some kind of virile sex symbol, you know, muscles and everything?
Well, they had a fellow at MGM by the name of Don Loomis, who was a weightlifter. And I went up for a part to somebody, and they said, go down to Don Loomis and put on 20 pounds. Well, I haven't put on 20 pounds for 20 years. But I went down to Don Loomis, and he looked, and he said, well, we have to start from scratch here. So I got hooked on this weightlifting thing. And he had all the health foods, black strap molasses, and I did all this. And I did all the weightlifting, and I found myself for the first time in my life in the morning and doing this, and the muscle came back, and I'm looking, and I couldn't wear my shirts anymore. I had to get new shirts, and I got bigger around here. I had to get another suit. And all this, and I did it for over a year. I didn't get the part that I but I got stronger. But finally, one day, when I'd gotten to lift really heavy weights, really heavy, and had gotten very good, I finally put it down. I said, I can't do this anymore. I thought, this is a mechanical thing. There's something wrong. I can't do this anymore. And in 3 weeks, I was back to 130 pounds, and I had to get a new shirt and change the whole thing. So that idea of changing my build didn't work.
No. Did it cause any comment when you went into the army, the medical? I mean, was there any danger you might not pass because you were undernourished, a famine victim?
Yeah, I was turned down at first because, the army always has charts. Yeah. If you're so tall, you're supposed to weigh. Right. Well, I didn't weigh enough for that. But I sort of bribed them. I just said, don't look at the chart. So I didn't step on the scales, and I didn't for the rest of my Army career.
Which was, of course, in the... and must have been a problem, too, of you, sort of a famous film star being in the forces. I mean, did you have any...
It was at first, because I was drafted, is what I was, and it was at first, but... once I started flying, it got a little more serious, and then once I got over here in the war, there was no problem because everyone sort of, all of us were in the same boat, you know, and you didn't worry about a film actor or anything. It was had a job to do, and that was it.
Well, you were so pursued by the ladies, were you, in the early days?
Well,
you speak freely on this program.
Well, I it was fun being a bachelor.
What about getting back into movies? Because you started with a bang, didn't you? With a marvelous movie made by Frank Capra. It's a Wonderful Life. How did that? I mean, did you want to get back into the movies?
Oh, I certainly did.
Yeah,
but I. It was sort of a nebulous period in my career because I didn't exactly know whether the type of thing that I'd done before, whether that would be accepted. And it turned out that it wasn't very accepted. That's It's a Wonderful Life didn't do very well.
Didn't it?
And the next picture didn't do very well. And it was sort of falling back on that sort of thing that I'd gotten into, the romantic comedy, and that people didn't want that.
Yeah. But before you go on then, Jimmy, come have a look at the scene then from from Wonderful Life.
Yeah.
I didn't realize, in fact, that it wasn't a commercial success, because it's a nice little movie, isn't it?
But it's amazing. It's my favorite picture and Frank Capra's favorite picture.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Dear Father in Heaven, I'm not a praying man, but if you're up there and you can hear me, show me the way. I'm at the end of my rope. Show me the way, oh God.
Are you all right, George? Want somebody to take you home, huh?
Why you drink so much, my friend? Please go home, Mr. Bailey. This is Christmas Eve.
Bailey? Which Bailey?
This Mr. George Bailey.
You said, Jimmy, that was your favorite movie of all.
Mm.
Of all the movies you've made, why is that?
I don't know. A lot of reasons. I just noticed that scene there. That scene, I remember when I first read the first draft of the script, and that scene, the little prayer, affected me. And when I read it first, when I did it in the movie, it did, and it did the same to me right now. And this is a theory that I've always had, that creating moments in movies, this I think is the important thing. Nobody knows exactly how it happens, but what you should do is to prepare yourself as best you can to make these moments happen. Because in a movie, it's really not so much the performance. It's really not. There are moments. There are moments, just like there, I think.
What about playing? Because you've played you mentioned one already, Lindbergh, but you've played a couple of other people who are real people, haven't you? Is there, as far as you're concerned, an actor, is it more difficult to represent somebody? It's not.
No, I don't think so.
No.
Not in my experience.
No.
Yeah.
What about the problems of becoming somebody that you're not and having to do it well? I mean, for instance, I'm thinking now of the Glenn Miller story. I mean, did you learn how to play trombone, for instance?
Well, this was a problem, you know, and I was determined to be believable as far as the trombone, because it was very much a part of the character. And a man by the name of Joe Euchel, who had been a musician, an excellent trombone man, for years in Hollywood, is still there, actually, and is still playing. He was assigned as my teacher. And he said, it was a big, jolly fellow, and he said, well, there's no problem here, Jim. I'm not only going to teach you the stuff that you have to do in this picture. I'll teach you to play the trombone. It'll be a wonderful thing for you for the rest of your life, because it's a wonderful instrument, and you'll like it. So let's start. And after about 5 days, he came to me. This is Francis Robinson Duff all over again. He came to me and said, I'm going to have to quit. He said, the sounds that come out of that horn when you play it are doing things to me. I go home and I kick the dog. I've had 5 fights with my wife. I overslept this morning. I I'm in terrible shape. We solved the problem by plugging up the mouthpiece so that it was impossible for me to make any sound. And I learned the breathing, and I learned the positions on the slide.
Yes.
And actually, I did it sort of like cue cards that they use sometimes in television, only he would, in a tune, Joe Yuko would put the positions.
Yeah.
And I learned the tremolo thing, and that's the way we worked that.
Yeah. Directed by Anthony Mann.
Anthony Mann.
Yeah, somebody who I didn't know, in fact, until you told me when watching the movie, somebody who, of course, directed you in a lot of very fine westerns, particularly, didn't he?
Yes.
How did you start in westerns, Jimmy? I mean, was there a point in your career where...
No, it was a... as I say, after the war, the things that I had done before the war just weren't going. I'd gone back to the stage. I'd done the play Harvey. I'd taken Frank Fay's place for several months while he took a vacation. I wanted to do the movie of it and did get to do the movie, although I don't think I was right for it because I was too young. But when I did the movie, they threw in a Western script that had been around for a long time, nobody wanted to do. This was a thing called Winchester 73, which got me started in the Western business. And I actually feel that if I hadn't at that point, if I hadn't started and done Westerns, if I hadn't gotten into that part of the business, it would have been, I don't think I would have made it.
Really?
No.
That's interesting. Do you actually like making Westerns?
Yes, and I think it's much more than that. I hear again, if you talk to John Wayne about it, it's much more than, well, what do you like, the Westerns or drawing room comedies or the melodramas and everything. The Western is really an original of American films. This is ours.
Mm. It's just one unique contribution.
That's right. Mm. No one else has this. And this, over the years, there have been ups and downs of the interest in Western. Why this is, I don't know. But I don't, you talk about survivability of the picture business and so on, I don't think I don't think you can lick the classic Western concept.
The John Ford Western.
Yeah.
Mm. There was a director you worked with as well who must have been fascinating. Did he make things happen on set?
He'll talk your head off about that because he is absolutely convinced that the moment idea, that this is it. Of course, he goes much further. Absolutely believed, and of course he lies a lot, but I think he believes it when he says it, that most of the good things in movies happen by accident, and he certainly does it, and you can see that he has this theory when he's directing a film. I call it planned improvisation. Mm-hmm. Because he's very well prepared. He knows the camera. He knows composition. I don't know what he thinks about actors, but I think that's good. I think this is planned. He gets actors sort of working, competing with each other, and he keeps actors from knowing exactly what's going to happen next. And all this works toward this planned improvisation. And I don't know of anybody else that does this, but this, I think, is a wonderful means of every once in a while catching these moments.
Yes. But that must be frightening for an actor, not to know what's going to happen next.
Oh, you don't. But this, everything goes up for grabs, and nobody knows exactly what's going to happen. He'll do things. I did a picture with Richard Widmark, and I hadn't worked with him before, and Ford came up to me the first day and said, this Whitmark's a pretty good country actor, now watch him, because he'll fix you.
Well, I said, so I did watch him. But it was fine.
But at the end of the picture, Dick told me that Ford came to him and told him the same thing about me. You know, this is getting... And when they say, people say, well, it's Ford, everything wonderfully organized and everything quiet on a Ford set. There's nothing quiet about a Ford set. There's tension, and there's... because everybody doesn't exactly know what's going to happen next.
Yeah.
And this is good. Yeah. This is a part of the magic of film, which I think has always been there and is still there.
Yeah. But is it true that you wore the same hat through all your westerns?
Yes. I've been sort of have a superstition about hats. My father gave me a hat years ago that I still have, that I wore in Harvey. And I when the first western I did, I got a hat, and it finally wore out because it wasn't a very good hat to start with. And but I kept bringing it on the set to have it there so it wouldn't break the spell. But I had trouble with Ford. Because in the first picture I did for him, he wanted me to wear one of Duke Wayne's hats, and it was a terrible big thing. I wouldn't go didn't want to. And so we had our first run-in, and I had my hat there, and we had a terrible thing. But he finally said I could wear my hat. I know. But he said, the next, if you ever work for me again, which I doubt, I want you to have it in your contract that you have hat approval. And I didn't, you don't take it lightly, Mr. Ford. So I did have it in my contract. And then the next picture was Liberty Valance, and he wouldn't let me wear a hat in that at all.
You kept the same horse, too, didn't you? You had that.
Same horse, yeah. Same horse for 21 years.
Good Lord. Did anybody else ever have it in the meantime? I mean,
yes, Audie Murphy touted me onto the horse. It was blonde to a little girl by the name of Stevie Myers, who was the daughter of a old wrangler for W.S. Hart and all the old boys. And she still is in the horse business for the movies. But she had the horse, and the horse had, his name was Pie, and the horse had hurt some people and was sort of a mean. And she didn't even show him to him, but I noticed him over there. And he was a nice looking, little, small horse. I found out he's quarter horse and thoroughbred, actually, is sort of a mixture. And I asked to ride him, and I think it was almost a human thing between us. I think we liked each other.
Yes.
And I got so, I really talked to this horse. I know he understood. I know. Yeah. I know one night, boy, I'm coming into a town, and I have a little bell on the horn of the saddle, and this sort of identifies me. And the bad guys are in the saloon, they're going to get me. And they hear the bell, and they say, here he comes. Now what Pi had to do, the camera goes on Pi's legs and then cut to the bad guys in there and goes on as Pi's walking, and then it goes up and there's nobody on Pi and he's walking. And they say, now how long is it going to take you to get Pi to walk? And then, and it was 3 o'clock at night and there were lights and everything. How long is it going to get you take you to get Pi to walk down this long street all by himself? And I said, I'll talk to him. And I went back, and I said, Pi, now this is tough because you're a horse, but you have to walk straight down there, and I'm not going to be on you, you see, but you have to walk right straight down and clear to the other end of the set. And the fellow says, how long is it going to take? You're going to talk all night? I said, no, I think you'll do it. So they that was a dolly shot, you know, with oil.
So they rolled the cameras, and Pye did it the first time. It was amazing, amazing. I loved him. I loved the horse.
I think he tells smashing stories.
Apropos of nothing at all, except you and I know what we're talking about, I hear that you and your wife are very bad at remembering anniversaries.
Yes, yes, we are. I don't know why that is, when the two grown people can't remember when you were born and when your wife was born. It's been very embarrassing over there. We would just forget. And yesterday, Gloria opened a cable from America, and it said, have a nice time on your trip to Amsterdam. We're going over to Amsterdam for a couple of days. And Gloria showed this to me and said, why would they, this is from my business manager's office. He said, why would he send this? He knows you're going to Amsterdam. Why would he send best wishes for that? What she didn't know was this was code for tomorrow is Gloria's birthday. And so this is the way I found out. And today is Gloria's birthday.
And she's
and,
in
there's the birthday girl.
You see, it's all in code. Gloria, is he as absent-minded as this?
Well, yeah, he's a little vague at times. For instance, he's vague really at important times. After our twins were born, I was a turn for the worst, you know, for a while. And I was in the hospital maybe 6 weeks, 2 months. And finally, I'm coming home. Today's the day I leave the hospital. Now, Jimmy's been to see me every day. He's been living and dying over all this trauma he's going through. And, you know, 2 months in the hospital, you collect a lot of stuff. You know, there are vases and presents for the babies and all sorts of things. So he came to pick me up, and he said, now, what I'll do, I'll take all this stuff down, and I'll put it in the car, and then you come down, you know, they make you leave in a wheelchair. Or you come down, and I'll pick you up at the ambulance entrance. Okay, off he goes. I go to the ambulance entrance, and I wait. And the nurse says, what could have happened to Mr. Stewart? I said, he forgot. Oh, she said, no, Mrs. Stewart, he couldn't have forgotten. I said, he forgot. I said, we'll go back upstairs. I said, he'll phone. So we waited a while, the phone rang. I said, hello. There's a long pause. By that, I always know it's Jimmy. There's a long pause. He said, honey? I said, yeah, all right, dear. I said, you come back down and I'll meet you. What he had done, he was so used to coming to the hospital, getting in the car and going home, that he did it. And he stopped by the photographers. Pick up some pictures, and photographer said, and how is Mrs. Stewart? He said, she's Mrs. Stewart. And he came back and got me. And that's the truth.
That's extraordinary.
The nurse couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
Didn't surprise me a bit.
Can you define for us, Jimmy, the character that you've come to be associated with through all your movies? I mean, we've all got our very definite ideas of what Jimmy Stewart's like on screen, the kind of character portrays, but have you ever thought of that, analyzed it yourself?
I really haven't analyzed it very much. I imagine that sort of an overall look at it would be, I'm the plodder, I'm the inarticulate man that tries, that I'm a pretty good example of true human frailty. I I don't really have all the answers. I have very few of the answers, but for some reason, somehow, I make it.
Yeah.
I get through. When I'm at the head of the wagon train, for some reason, we get across the road.
James Stewart, who died recently aged 89. We leave you with him doing a party piece in the company of his wife, Gloria. They were married for 45 years, and after she died in 1994, he became a virtual recluse. She once interrupted her husband halfway through a shaggy dog story with the immortal line, and I quote, "My dear, stop behaving like Jimmy Stewart." And I think this is an example of what she meant.
Yes, we've got an accordion.
Oh, dear.
There you are, sir. Your accordion. It's a present from your wife, actually.
No.
There.
Well, now, here I am. Well, the first thing you do, you feel along here on these buttons, and one of them has a flat top. And then you know that you're... at least you have one chord. Now, fellas, help me out, will you? I'm going to play the last eight bars of a tune called "The One I Love Belongs to Somebody Else." And it's an old tune, but if you don't recognize it, don't feel too badly.
All the time, Gloria?
Yes, he is. He really is.
You're a very lucky person.